English we speak.
From BBC Learning English.
Hello and welcome to the English we speak. I'm Neil and I'm waiting for Lee.
Ouch! Oh. I'm Lee. Here on the floor, I went head over heels. But I'm ready to present the programme, Neil.
Are you okay, Lee? Let me help you up.
Oh, thank you. I appreciate your helping me to stand up.
I'm sorry you fell over like that. You sounded so cheerful. So you are head over heels, Lee. Who's the lucky guy?
The lucky guy? What do you mean, Neil?
Well, the one you're head over heels in love with. Is it anyone I know?
Anyone you know? I don't know what you're talking about, Neil. I've just fallen flat on my face.
You said that you're head over heels. This is an expression we use in English to say that you had such a dramatic fall that your head was over your feet, and we use it when we want to say that someone fell madly in love.
Oh, that's when you say that someone has fallen head over heels for another person.
You can also imagine you're a gymnast doing somersaults or cartwheels. Your head goes literally over your heels.
Yeah, it makes sense. When you are in love, it might mean that you are so happy that you feel like jumping around.
They met at a dinner party and fell head over heels for each other.
He is gorgeous. I'm head over heels in love with him.
She is a hopeless romantic. She's always head over heels in love with somebody.
So, who is it, Lee? Who have you fallen head over heels in love with? I promise I won't tell a soul.
Neil, I came here very excited to present a programme with you. But I must say now, oh, my head hurts.
Your head hurts?
Oh, my feet are sore.
Feet are sore? What's been going on?
But I'm certainly not in love with this bin that made me fall over.
Okay, so no juicy gossip for us today. Well, we'd better say goodbye.
No juicy gossip. And let's finish the programme because I'd better go and have an aspirin. Bye.
The English we speak.
From BBC Learning English.
Hello and welcome to The English We Speak. I'm Feifei.
And I'm the new improved Roy.
Wow, Roy, you look really different. Why are you wearing a suit?
Well, I decided to give some of my old clothes away to charity and start wearing my suit and tie and cut my hair short. Also, I'm wearing these shoes that have a metal sole to reduce my plastic footprint.
You know that plastic footprint doesn't relate specifically to your shoes, right? Plastic footprint relates to the amount of plastic you use in your everyday life.
Yep. And I'm very aware of the amount of plastic I use. In fact, I get really angry when I receive or buy something that uses unnecessary plastic packaging.
Roy, I've never heard you get angry before. I'm really impressed you care about plastic footprint.
Well, I only get upset when it relates to the future of the planet, a planet my son and his children will inherit. Let's listen to these examples.
I've tried to avoid buying things that use too much plastic packaging because I'm very aware of my plastic footprint. The shop has started using paper bags to reduce its plastic footprint. First it was carbon, now it's our plastic footprint we have to reduce. I have to read more about it.
This is the English we speak from BBC Learning English, and we're talking about the expression plastic footprint. This relates to the amount of plastic that we use in our everyday life. Roy, how are you reducing your plastic footprint?
Well, first of all, whenever I buy a coffee, I use a reusable coffee cup. Also, when you buy things, Do you use single-use plastic bags?
No, I don't. I have reusable bags that are made of cloth rather than plastic. What else can be done?
Well, bringing your own bottle to drink water can help, and also avoiding plastic cutlery. I always take my cutlery from home. Do you drink a lot of tea?
Yes, I do. Why?
Well, you should always make sure that the tea bags you use are biodegradable if you want to reduce your plastic footprint.
I didn't know that. Well, speaking of tea, do you want a cup?
I'd love one.
Me too. Now go and make me one while I do some work. Bye, Roy.
Okay, Feifei. Bye.
The English We Speak
from BBC Learning English.
Hello and welcome to The English We Speak from BBC Learning English. I'm Feifei. Excuse me, Neil. Could we have your attention, please?
Oh, sorry. I was just playing this computer game. I'm so addicted. I just need to get the zombies to jump in the jelly and...
Okay. I get the idea. But why are you looking so serious?
Serious? Oh, no. I'm not looking serious. I'm concentrating. This is my game face.
Oh, that's a game face. I wondered what one was, and now I know. If we describe someone as having a game face, we mean they're having an intense, serious expression because they're focused and determined to win a game or achieve something they want. Neil, you're serious about winning the game?
Yes, just one more zombie in the jelly to go.
Let's have some examples, shall we?
You could tell by his game face that he was going to win. Look at Jaya's game face. You can tell she is determined to win the race. Put your game face on when you go to the bank and ask to borrow some money.
You're listening to The English We Speak from BBC Learning English. Neil's telling me about his game face, a serious or intense facial expression that someone has when they're determined to win something. Is this a face we only use for computer games?
No, we can use it for board games, chess, sport also. Anywhere where you need to focus to win the game or just achieve something important. Now, please be quiet. I need to finish this game.
Oh, sorry, Neil.
Oh, no!
What's wrong?
The game has frozen. It won't work.
So, is that your game face I'm looking at now?
No, this is just my angry face.
No. Dear, we could call it your game over face. Bye.
The English We Speak
from BBC Learning English.
Hello and welcome to The English We Speak. I'm Jiaying.
And hello, I'm Rob. Biting my tongue.
Rob, bite your tongue is our phrase today, but you don't have to physically do it.
Oh, phew. Biting my tongue was painful, and it was very hard to speak.
Well, that's why we sometimes tell people to bite their tongue. You see, when we bite our tongue, we are stopping ourselves from saying something that might offend or upset someone. It might be inappropriate too. You might also say to someone else, bite your tongue. It means don't say it. But, Rob, we don't physically bite our tongues.
Right, so for example, I shouldn't tell someone they've put on weight. I should bite my tongue.
Exactly. Just like the people in these examples.
I wanted to tell him his new shirt looked awful, but I decided to bite my tongue. I know the food's not great, but please bite your tongue and just eat it. I had to bite my tongue when my friend kept bragging about her great exam results.
This is The English We Speak from BBC Learning English. We're learning about the phrase, bite your tongue, which means to stop yourself from saying something offensive, hurtful, or inappropriate. So, Rob, we shouldn't tell people we think they've gained a bit of weight, should we?
No, we should bite our tongue.
Good. And I will bite my tongue about your weight.
Excuse me, what about my weight?
Sorry, Rob. I am biting my tongue.
Maybe saying nothing at all is better than saying something. Do you fancy a biscuit?
Thanks, Rob.
Bye. Ow! I've bitten my tongue.
The English We Speak.
From BBC Learning English.
This is The English We Speak. With me, Feifei.
And me, Rob. Now, our piece of authentic real English in this programme is, Feifei?
Twiddle your thumbs.
Oh, OK, I will. What are we waiting for?
Nothing, Rob. Twiddle your thumbs is the phrase.
Oh, sorry, Feifei. I thought you were telling me to wait around, not do anything until something happens.
Why would I do that?
So you can watch me twiddle my thumbs?
No, Rob. The informal phrase twiddle your thumbs means to wait around doing nothing until something happens. But you can twiddle your thumbs again while we listen to some examples.
Where have you been? I've been twiddling my thumbs waiting for you to arrive. Just twiddle your thumbs while we work out how the computer works. I've been twiddling my thumbs because I arrived early for the meeting.
This is The English We Speak from BBC Learning English, and we're learning about the phrase twiddle your thumbs, which means do nothing while waiting for something to happen.
We don't actually have to twiddle our thumbs when we have nothing to do, do we?
Of course not. It just describes having nothing to do.
So you mean being bored?
Yes, exactly. And you know what's a good solution to stop you from twiddling your thumbs?
No.
Do something, like making your colleague a nice cup of tea.
Hint taken. See you later.
Bye.
The English We Speak.
From BBC Learning English.
Welcome back, Feifei. Good holiday.
The best, Neil. We flew to Mexico, then up to California, and then drove all the way across the states from LA to New York.
Incredible. All in 1 week?
Yes. It's just that...
What?
I can't help thinking. All that travelling can't be great for the environment.
I know. You must have a pretty big carbon footprint right now.
Enormous.
Let's take a moment to explain this phrase, carbon footprint, then plan what to do about it.
Carbon dioxide is a gas that contributes to climate change.
And your carbon footprint is the amount of carbon dioxide you produce through your activities, things like how much electricity you use.
How much oil and gas you use.
What you eat is another factor, and of course your trips by car, plane, and so on.
If you take a lot of flights, then you have a large carbon footprint, like me.
And me, and the people in these examples.
I use the air conditioning non-stop all summer. My carbon footprint must be huge.
Martina has the highest carbon footprint of all her colleagues. She drives everywhere, flies every weekend, and eats nothing but red meat.
I downloaded an app to calculate my carbon footprint. The results are pretty shocking.
You're listening to The English We Speak from BBC Learning English. The expression we're looking at in this programme is carbon footprint. OK, we've heard the examples, and Neil, I have a plan. It's time to reduce my footprint.
Great. That's the verb we normally use, reduce. We talk about reducing our carbon footprint by changing the way we live. So, what's the plan?
I'm going to cycle to work, use less heating in winter, and I've got these new shoes.
Great. But shoes?
They're made of recycled plastic. Fantastic, aren't they?
Well, that's one way to reduce your footprint.
I even bought you a pair, a little present from my trip to LA.
You're so kind. I can wear them when I'm in Tokyo this weekend and Paris next week. Oh, in Iceland tomorrow. Only kidding.
Yes, I want to hear your plan to reduce your carbon footprint, Neil.
Bye.
Bye.
The English We Speak.
From BBC Learning English.
Hello and welcome to The English We Speak. It's me, Feifei.
And it's me, Rob. Now, Feifei, have you been baking again?
I have, Rob. As you can see, I've been very busy. So feast your eyes on these cookies.
Oh, wow, so many. Thanks. I'll start with the chocolate chip cookies, shall I?
Stop. What are you doing?
Well, I'm feasting on your cookies. Like you said, you meant eat lots, didn't you?
No, I said feast your eyes on them, not just feast on them.
Oh, so no eating, just looking.
Exactly. To feast your eyes on something means enjoy or even be amazed by looking at something because of the quality, quantity or beauty of what you see. So, Rob, you can look at all my amazing cookies, but don't eat them.
Oh, really?
Yes, really. Now, feast your eyes and ears on these examples instead.
This is the best room in the hotel. Feast your eyes on the amazing view. I've prepared a special birthday meal. Feast your eyes on all this food. The new art exhibition is a feast for your eyes. The artist has used so many colours.
This is the English we speak from BBC Learning English, and we're hearing about the phrase feast your eyes on something. It means look at or be amazed by what you see.
But Feifei, what is the point of just looking at the food and not eating it?
Because they aren't for you. They're a present for Roy. It's his birthday. But if you ask him nicely, he might just give you one.
Just one cookie isn't really a feast, but it's better than just looking.
Rob, I think your eyes are bigger than your belly.
Oh, thanks, Feifei. Now, hurry up and give Roy his birthday present, please.
OK, bye.
Bye-bye. The English we speak.
From BBC Learning English.
Welcome to The English We Speak with me, Jiaying.
Me, Neil.
Are you OK, Neil? You look really tired.
I am. But my best friend is living with me and he's a nightmare. He never does the washing up. He plays his guitar all day, which he's rubbish at. I'm just so stressed. I can't relax.
Sounds like he's living rent-free in your head.
What? No, Jiayang, rent is important and he pays that. He's just annoying to live with. Why do you think he doesn't pay rent?
No, Neil. I said live rent-free in your head. We use this expression to say we can't stop thinking about something or someone. It can be used to talk about things or people you love or that annoy you. It commonly relates to thinking about something or someone to the point of becoming obsessed.
Ah, that makes sense. I thought you were saying I have a big head and someone could live in it. I didn't think that comment through.
Well, now you know. We can talk more about it after these examples.
Juan loves Kika so much, she lives rent-free in his head. The moment we lost the football final lives rent-free in my head. I can't stop thinking about what could have been. You need to stop thinking about your argument with him. He's living rent-free in your head.
You're listening to The English We Speak from BBC Learning English, and we're talking about the expression live rent-free in one's head. We use this expression to talk about something or someone we can't stop thinking about.
Yes, for example, I became totally obsessed with videos on decorating cakes, and they lived rent-free in my head. I loved it so much.
Instead of saying live rent-free in your head, you could say can't get something or someone out of your mind.
Like my best friend, I can't stop thinking about him.
Yes, he's really annoying you. Have you decided what to do with him?
I have. I told him your address and now he's coming to live with you.
Oh no! Then he'll be living rent-free in my head.
Just joking. I'd never do that.
Bye, Neil.
Bye. The English we speak. From the BBC.